The Omicron variant fuels a record weekly high of new COVID-19 cases. The World Health Organization says more than 15 million infections were reported globally last week. But it admits that number is an underestimate. Despite soaring cases, the WHO says reported deaths have remained stable. And while hospitalizations are also increasing, it is not at the level seen in previous waves.
Let's be clear. While Omicron causes less severe disease than Delta, it remains a dangerous virus, particularly for those who are unvaccinated. Almost 50,000 deaths a week is 50,000 deaths too many. Learning to live with this virus does not mean we can or should accept this number of deaths. We must not allow this virus a free ride or wave the white flag, especially when so many people around the world remain unvaccinated.
Back here at home, the Philippine government eyes to shorten the quarantine period for fully vaccinated individuals despite the continued rise in COVID cases. Under the proposal, the isolation period for vaccinated individuals with a symptomatic or mild COVID-19 will be shortened to 7 days. Their close contacts who are fully vaccinated would only have to isolate for 5 days. Meanwhile, the unvaccinated or partially inoculated that are probable, mild, or asymptomatic cases will have to undergo isolation for 10 days. Meanwhile, the unvaccinated or will have to undergo isolation for 10 days.
From evidence, we also see the continuous rise in the number of cases, that most of the cases remains to be asymptomatic and mild cases, showing the effectiveness of our vaccines against severe disease and death. Also, most recent evidence on Omicron variant also shows that it tends to present with milder symptoms. The prolonged quarantine and isolation duration has been causing strain to our healthcare system and our economy. And our experts believe that specifically for the Omicron variant, the benefits of shortening quarantine outweighs the risk. This seems to be consistent with global practice as we see other countries updating its quarantine and isolation processes.
The proposed changes in the isolation period not sitting well with Philippine College of Physicians President Dr. Maricar Limpin.
Okay lang kung puro Omicron lang kasi parang medyo hindi siya ganun talaga palala, di ba? Pero may kasamang Delta variant. So alam natin na ang Delta variant talagang medyo severe ang mga sakit na dulot nito. Eh kung very short yung natin, then yung gagamitin natin for the general public, eh baka maraming madisgrasya.
The health department is also looking to shift to targeted contact tracing in Metro Manila to maximize resources. This means tracing will focus on the vulnerable population and less on those who came in close contact with a COVID-positive patient. Some health experts backing the proposal.
Because of the epidemiologic situation, assessment natin sa ating sitwasyon sa ngayon, because of the very high transmission rate in our community, specifically here in NCR, hindi ho priority ngayon ang contact tracing.
For example, may isang kaso, ang hahanapin mo, meron po ba kayo mga kamag-anak or na-encounter na may comorbidities, matanda, di ba, or bata? So mas specific yung hinahanap natin na itetrace rather than itatanong mo sino lahat ang iyong nagkaroon ka ng contact.
But the country's contact tracing chief has his reservations.
Sana huwag na pag-undermine yung contact tracing because critical pa rin yan doon sa ating strategy. Contact tracing dictates yung testing rate. The more you contact trace, the more tests you conduct, the higher test that you conduct, you'll be able to seek out yung mga positive.
The Philippines is facing a shortage in contact tracers. Just this year, 16,000 contact tracers were terminated because of lack of funds. Now, the spike in COVID-19 cases among healthcare workers affecting the COVID-19 vaccine rollout in parts of the Philippines. At least two municipalities in Cavite have temporarily suspended inoculations. These include Tanza, which plans to resume vaccinations next week, but only for those who have appointment. In Mandaluyong City, only one vaccination site is open. The rest will remain closed until Saturday, January 15th, to give way for disinfection. 28 more areas in the Philippines placed under COVID alert level 3. The higher alert level will take effect Friday and will be enforced until the end of the month. Alert level 3 will cover 16 more Luzon provinces, 7 more localities in the Visayas region, and 5 more areas in Mindanao. Government earlier placed 19 areas, including Metro Manila, under alert level 3. The Philippine Education Department says the proposed academic break cannot be implemented nationwide. According to Undersecretary Nepomuceno Malaluan, it's now up to regional offices to impose an academic break if the situation warrants it. He adds they can also implement a so-called academic ease, wherein teachers can minimize the schoolwork of students.
Mahirap gawin nationwide ito sapagkat this will seriously affect. We have to balance this also, kabayan, dun sa ating learning process and school calendar. So hindi naman pangkalahatan yung nangangailangan. So kung may merong ganito na may masiting pangangailangan to do class suspensions, we are authorizing our regions and divisions to do so.
Opo.
The Parent Teachers Association Federation, meanwhile, is not in favor of an academic break. They believe teachers only need a good time management system to deal with these challenges.
Katatapos din lang ng Christmas break, which is December. And then, ano pa lang ngayon, this January 13, 9 days pa lang ng pasukan. I don't think they can call it pasukan, but it was early learning activities. 9 days pa lang. Tapos, ipapatupad natin ng health break, mm-hmm. academic health break. I don't know if it's makatwiran yung implement natin yan. Sunod-sunod ng vacation I think this is a time management lang po ang gusto i-emphasize. Okay. And if not, they can tap the PTA to have the printing, segregation, and checking. Pwede po, itap nilang PTA.
The Commission on Human Rights slams the Transportation Department's no vaccination, no ride policy in Metro Manila. The CHR said the rule restricts a person's fundamental right to travel. It adds the move also prevents the general public from accessing essential goods and services. The Transportation Department has defended the policy and says only a small portion of Metro Manila's population will be affected, with 91% of residents already vaccinated. Local transport group also raising concerns over the no vaccine, no ride policy in Metro Manila. JB Group Piston says it will only bring added work to drivers to check if their passengers are vaccinated or not. It adds the group was not even consulted about the policy.
Sa bahagi po namin, i-implement po namin yung policy na batay doon sa inilabas ng guidelines ng ITA. Pero paano naman po yung mga pasahero na talagang gusto po gusto sumakay at pumunta sa kanilang paruroonan? Dapat ang tingin po namin ay masusipay itong pinag-aralan ng DOTR bago ito in-implement.
Another transport group says the policy may not be implemented properly.
Ang gusto nilang mangyari, yun lang po aming mga conductor ang mag-control kung yung pasaherong sumasakay may vaccine card o wala. So hindi po yun nagiging realidad dahil dapat po ang gobyerno magtayo ng pulisya na sa lahat ng bus stop meron pong enforcers ng gobyerno, merong tumutulong.
The controversial no vaccination, no ride policy will also be implemented at the LR2 line. Its operator said passengers must present either a copy of their vaccination card, a vaccine certification from the health department, or an IATF prescribed document. For those not covered by the rule, they must still present either a medical certificate, a health pass from their village, or any proof that they are allowed to travel.